Let me let you guys in on a little secret. You can get a head start on your Black Friday shopping at Macy's Black Friday Early Access. They're giving you early access to specials on your favorite brands and beauty essentials from November 7th to November 19th. The best part? No waiting in long lines or getting up early. It's all online at Macy's.com/Black Friday. But only while supplies last. So get your holiday shopping done before Thanksgiving and have your cake or pie too. That's Macy's.com/Black Friday. What's up, everybody? This is Alyssa Amoroso, aka Publicity, who is ready to spill some tea. Because this is Tea with Publicity. Let's get into today's episode. This is my ninth attempt. See, that's why, at recording this intro. I wish I could be I'm so hungover because I am just living my best life here in LA. But the truth is, it's day two of my period. That's really the truth. And I would normally record my intro earlier, but I needed to do it in the moment so you guys knew what I've been getting up to in real time. So really, I did it for you. I'm super selfless. I'm torturing myself so you guys could have the latest and greatest. No, I'm kidding. But it is really fitting that today's episode is with Lo Bosworth from Laguna Beach / The Hills, because what a better LA episode than one with Mrs. California herself, Lo Bosworth. So stick around. We are going to get into that. If you guys are new here and you found me through Lo, hello, welcome to the pod. We discuss mental health, pop culture, dating, all things girly. So buckle up because I'm going to get you up to speed with what I've been up to before we get into the interview. And then we will wrap the show by spilling the tea because I went to Dancing with the Stars last night and we need to discuss that. There's a lot we need to discuss with Love is Blind. And I've been seeing some celebrities here. There's also celebrities taking this new drug called Ozempic that we need to talk about. So stay tuned for that. First, let me catch you up to speed on my life in LA. So 10 years in New York, packed up, moved to LA for the winter, and I feel like a new person. I don't know why. I don't know what changed. I don't know if it's the place or if it's just me needing new energy in my life, or if the energy here just suits me better. I'm feeling more motivated, on quite frankly, less depressed. Not that I was depressed in New York, but less depressed. I'm just feeling, I can't even explain it because it's just innately in my core. Do you know, it's just a shift that I was actually hoping to feel this shift, but I wasn't positive I was going to. And I was having a lot of pressure on the fact that I want to feel this shift, but what if I go there and I don't? Moving is not the problem then. Then you really got to look in the mirror and be what the hell's the problem? But it really helped. Listen, not all my prayers are answered, but I'm feeling hopeful. I'm feeling really reinvigorated with work and my career here. I'm feeling just positive, and I can't even say it's the weather because it's literally been raining since the second I got here, which is so weird because it doesn't rain in LA. And of course I get here, I'm great, I brought the New York weather with me. But regardless, it's been fun. I've been go. I've had plans nearly every single day. I've been going to more events, meeting new people. I think I'm really excited about today because since it is day two of my period and I'm miserable, it's rainy. So I'm also today will be my day of rest and relaxation and listening to my body because I need to slow it down a little bit. But my first day here, I got in and got in an accident, which is crazy. So I'm doing a partnership with Mazda. which is really exciting. They gave me a car for these first few weeks since I'm in LA, and I was driving to Target because I had to get some things for my apartment, and I went to the one in Santa Monica because I was had a meeting in Santa Monica and I was just right there. Small ass parking lot, pull into the parking lot. This little 80 something year old man doesn't look behind him, backs up, hits my car. I'm like, you have to be freaking kidding me. I've been here for less than 24 hours. I'm in this car that I don't own and someone already just hit it and damaged it. I felt bad. Like, he was old. People make mistakes. Like, I somehow found myself thanking him. I was like, thank you so much for hitting me. Like, what? I just felt bad. I didn't want to make him feel guilty. And he was so cute. And he like immediately admitted fault, you know, like he hit me. And then he was like, he like shrugged and he goes, I guess I'll go get my registration. I was like, oh, dagger to the heart. So it is what it is. That's why people have insurance, I guess. So just like sucked because it's like, oh, great. People are going to think I'm the shitty driver because I got in an accident after not having a car for 10 years. But no, I got hit. It's embarrassing. But anyway, still didn't put a damper on my time here. I am in my Airbnb. I know a lot of people keep asking me on TikTok for an apartment tour. Unfortunately, you're not going to get one. Just for safety reasons. Like, I just don't want to show my space. Also, like, it's not my furniture in it. It's someone else's. It's not like how I would decorate it. If I do get a place permanently, whether it be here or in New Jersey or wherever, like 100% you're getting a full-blown tour. And I'm still manifesting that Anthropologie furniture partnership. And I think we're getting closer because Anthropologie DM'd me on Instagram and was like, hey, what's your email? Like, our team wants to reach out. And I'm like, oh my God, do you think they saw the TikToks of me making floor plans with their furniture? So that would be great. But overall, yeah, LA, it's good. It's good. I don't even know. Like, I'm back on dating apps. I think there's a huge difference between dating app culture in New York and LA from what I've seen in my short time here. What I've noticed instantly is that I find that whether they mean it or not, a lot of the men have clearer intentions written out on their profiles here. Like, they will say, like, just looking to hook up or, like, looking for a long-term relationship. Whereas in New York, I found a lot of people opted out of that feature because, I don't know, everyone likes to be, like, so elusive and, like, not, like, non-committal. Whereas here, I find that people, like, profiles say, like, looking for a long-term relationship or, like, not really sure what I'm looking for, but open to trying. I'm like, okay, like, that's nice. The other main difference that I notice is jobs. New York, it's a lot of, you know, finance, marketing. Here, it's like producers, artists, music executives. A lot of people's pictures in New York are like in vests and like my daddy will sue you vibes with like collared shirts. And here it's a lot of people like on the red carpet with like cameras because they obviously work on the production side, or people like with a surfboard and like skateboard. So it's different. I haven't gone out on a date yet, but I will let you know when I do. Yeah, we'll see, I guess. And that's really it for right now because I want to get into this interview with Lo, and I think you guys will be really interested to hear about like what she's been up to these last 10 years that she hasn't been on our screens. She's super freaking impressive and very, very smart. It's so evident. We talk about what she does for self-care. She talks about a book that she has coming out. Like, it's just great. So here is the interview with Lo, and then stay tuned after because we're going to spill the tea on Dancing with the Stars. Ekin Su from Love Island messaged me. Yep. And we're going to talk about celebrities taking the drug Ozempic, the one that's making everyone lose weight. Plus, we're going to dig into Love is Blind. So I will see you at the end of the episode.
here with Lo Bosworth. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Alyssa. I'm really excited.
I'm so excited. And I feel like there's so much about you that people don't know necessarily in terms of like what you've done. Like, we've seen you on TV. We've seen you grace our screens. Like, I grew up watching The Hills, Laguna Beach. But what people don't know, a lot of people, I think, is that you're this like force between this entire female focused wellness brand. And I'm really interested in it because we talk a lot about self-care here. And I've been on my own journey with like self-care and self-love and figuring things out. I literally have so many questions just about your probiotics and your supplements and all of these things. Like, it's, I'm going
to
be like,
I can't wait to answer all of
them. Oh, it's crazy. But what like made you kind of take, I want to kind of get to like how you got here, like how you took that pivot from reality TV to entrepreneur, and like how you really just like cemented yourself in this industry.
Yeah. It's been a really interesting journey for me. And when I think, so I started Love Wellness more than 7 years ago now, and the team in New York, we're based in New York City, we're a team of 30 plus full-time people. And I just pinch myself when I think back on the journey that it that I have been going on to get to this place. And it's interesting when I talk to a lot of people, they don't know that, you know, I'm the founder of this business and that I operate it day to day. And I wouldn't say that that's purposeful necessarily. I just have not been a founder that is like super focused from a media and press perspective on like being on the cover of a magazine. Like, that stuff is great and it's great for the ego, but I don't find that it makes much of a difference in how you operate a business day to day. Right. Like, to, and don't get me wrong, like, it's delightful to have people recognize you for like what you do and for your achievements, but it's just not the driving focus for me behind why I started a company. We're a mission-driven business and the products we make are incredibly innovative and solves a lot of women's health issues that people just suffer with day to day, that they go to the doctor for, you know, and, you know, struggle to get help. So I'll take you back to the origin story because I'm like personally really invested in the company and what we do. And it's because of my own experience. So a number of years ago, I found myself really depressed and really anxious. And I fully recognize that that conversation has become much more acceptable in like a mainstream way. But when I was starting the company, not a lot of people were talking about, you know, mental illness or anything like that. And I really suffered in silence for a long time without really realizing or recognizing how common these types of things are. Mm-hmm. And so I went through a pretty, you know, emotionally challenging number of years. But alongside that, I also was dealing with like chronic yeast infections, UTIs. And I started going to the doctor because I'm a problem solver above all else. And I wanted to feel better. You know, I was waking up with like heart racing anxiety first thing in the morning. And I lived that way for years. It was really challenging, you know, physically and emotionally. So I started going to the doctor and I went from doctor to doctor to doctor. And it took 18 months for one of my doctors to finally do a blood panel that screened my vitamin levels. And I would assume that would be done earlier on in the process.
Yeah.
Coming to you chronically with, you know, symptoms over and over again that won't resolve themselves. But it took 18 months and, you know, this was back in 2015. So I don't actually think it was that uncommon at that time. It turns out I was dealing with some really severe vitamin deficiencies, specifically B12 and vitamin D. And those deficiencies cause a lot of neurological problems. Mm. And so with that revelation, I was able to tie back, you know, some of what I was experiencing to like a direct cause. And so that gave me some hope. But it took me a while longer to connect the dots between the vitamin D and the personal care issues that I was dealing with, because yeast infections and UTIs are not necessarily a byproduct of a vitamin deficiency, right? And over time, I realized that the gut and the vagina are two organs that are intimately connected. There's a gut-vagina axis, just like the brain-gut axis, the gut-brain axis that people know more and more about. And that at the very core, I had a absorption issue caused by gut health problems above all else. So my gut health problems were causing both my vitamin deficiencies challenge, you know, to having a challenging time absorbing nutrients, and like vaginal health, urinary tract issues, because the microbiome of the gut is sort of like the master microbiome. You can think of it like that. And the bacteria in your gut actually communicate with bacteria in and on different microbiomes on the body. It's called quorum sensing. You can think of it as like bacteria texting each other from one body part to the next. And if your gut bacteria are in disarray because you've been taking antibiotics since you were a baby, antacids, drinking booze, things that just generally upset the gut environment, chances are you're going to have gut health issues that like trickle up and down into different parts of the body. So if the gut
bacteria, that's what I have.
Yeah, that's what everybody has. So if your gut bacteria are in bad shape, they're going to text your vagina bacteria and be like, you be in bad shape too.
That's so interesting, because
fascinating.
I don't you feel like as a woman, we aren't taught enough about our bodies? I feel like it's getting a little better now. You know, over time, people are starting to kind of tune more into it and learn more and teach more. But even for me, like I went through something kind of similar where I was just feeling awful and I went to every doctor. And when you just go to like traditional doctors, they just are so focused on like their specialty that if you go to like a doctor for XYZ, that's all they're focusing on. And no one was like, no one was figuring out the issue for me, which wound up being like this inflammation and this allergy and this gluten and my gut health and all of these things that I really didn't get to the bottom of until I was like seeing functional medicine doctors. And I'm still working towards like every day. Like I still have like acid reflux issues and like I'm working on my gut health, but it's tough. Like it's really hard. So I get what drove this, because it's really frustrating to feel like you know something's wrong and no one could help you figure it out.
Yeah, it was really challenging. But ultimately, having these sort of aha moments about the science really led me to start Love Wellness, create the brand, build out our product pipeline. And we make products that focus really specifically on gut health, vaginal health, brain health, and how those systems all work together, right? And so our probiotics, we have a gut health probiotic, we have a vaginal health probiotic, we have a brain probiotic, we have vaginal suppositories. So we really are focused on supporting women's health, really like at the molecular level, which a lot of brands don't do or don't understand very well. But yeah, I always wondered, like, why am I not learning about this in school? Why is the doctor not telling me about it? And it's because research on women's bodies is still pretty limited. A lot of it is still anecdotal, but just because something is anecdotal doesn't mean that it's not legitimate, right? I think you get a pushback from like a lot of people with, you know, true science backgrounds. And there's like, where's scientific research? And it turns out a lot of it does exist. In fact, I'm coming out with a book at the end of the year that packages all of that scientific research up nicely with the bow for the very first time when it comes to women's health and their bodies, to like demystify the science behind the gut brain vaginal connection. But, you know, research doesn't hasn't gotten that far. But I'm like a firm believer that anecdotal evidence is really, really meaningful.
Absolutely. And that's awesome that you're coming out with a book, and like, it has to start somewhere. And I think that it is tough because people that are so sciencey, like you would expect that they are open to new developments, but they're also kind of closed-minded in the sense where they're very black and white with like, well, factually, this has been reported on and this hasn't, but it's like, yeah, but maybe you've never examined the female body the way it should be. Like a lot of studies are done on men, and no wonder we don't know this information because we're not always being super considered. And yeah, I think it's definitely interesting. And just like, this is my baseline question when I said I have so many. So your team was kind enough to send me a bunch of your products and I'm so excited, but I was looking at all of them and I'm like, could you mix and match? Like, could you take all of these things at once? Do you take them depending on the month? Like, tell me like the usage of these items. Cause like, that's where I feel overwhelmed as a consumer sometimes.
Absolutely. And answering those questions is actually something that we are trying to do better as a brand. So we're like working on our website right now, actually.
All brands could do it. Honestly, like I feel that way in the beauty space and the makeup space, skincare. It's like, okay, do I put the oil on first or do I do this first? Do I do that? Right. There's so much.
100%. So the thing with probiotics, vitamins, and supplements, suppositories, generally, if you are getting products from a single brand, they're making products that work well together. Let's just take our probiotic offering as an example here, because we make probiotics for different parts of the body. The reason that we do that is because different microbiomes are dominated by different strains of bacteria. And so our different probiotics have different types of bacteria in them that support your body for the different purposes, right? And so can those probiotics all be taken together? Yeah, absolutely. Can we put them all into a single capsule and still deliver you a product that's $29.99? No, because the cost of way too expensive.
I see.
Then we're talking about a $100 probiotic, right? And there's probiotic companies out there that are making probiotics for like one use case still and just completely ripping you off.
I'm picturing also like a monster pill.
Insider take. Yeah, a monster pill. Hot insider take. Like if you're taking a $100 probiotic and there's like two types of bacteria in there, you're definitely getting ripped off. So that's the reason why we don't like package them all together, right? Like the cost of goods just becomes too cost prohibitive for consumers, right? And so we really focus on different products that can be taken together, layered together, but that all ultimately support the overall goal of total body bliss, right? So if you have vaginal odor, as an example, we make Flora Power, which is a probiotic vaginal suppository that is like very one of a kind. It mixes probiotics with vitamin C, and vitamin C supports healthy bacteria balance. So like if you have BV, women in Canada already are using suppositories like this, but it's pretty new in the United States. And then we add probiotic bacteria to the suppository to help maintain good levels of bacteria moving forward. So you could also take that with an oral probiotic every day as sort of like a preventative maintenance policy, if that makes sense. So yes, everything can be taken together.
Okay, that makes sense. I figured, but again, there's so many things in every industry that I'm just like, I need a, like, almost like a map. I'm like, okay, like, what should I be doing? What should I, like, it gets really overwhelming, I think, for consumers sometimes. So that's good to know. When you really like left reality TV, cause that was, you were young still, you were like what, 24, 25?
Yeah. I think the year was 2010, which would have made me 24-ish.
Yeah. So that's a while ago. Yeah. What, because you are so knowledgeable and I just want to know like what happened in that like 10 year span that you know all of this now, or like, I can't even begin to explain how like interesting it is to hear from you and hear like you're just this wealth of knowledge. And I'm like, did she go to school? I think you went to culinary school. Like what what happened in those years that we kind of missed and we didn't see?
Yeah, I have lived many different versions of life. I would say it's because I have a lot of passions and interests. When I was younger, I think that was, I sort of like viewed it as flightiness, but as an adult, I have a deeper appreciation for just having like many different interests. But so yes, the Hills ended, I believe in 2010. I moved to New York shortly thereafter. And I have always been really deeply passionate about food and cooking. So when I came to New York, I went to the French Culinary Institute because I had it in mind that I wanted to be like the next Martha Stewart, right? I was like, wow. I was on TV, I can have a cooking show. And I actually thought I went down the road of doing that, like with food and cooking, and then the deal fell apart and they just changed their mind, which is fine, right? It should happen. But I was like on that path, and while I was on that path, I started to learn more about nutrition and about a different way to think about food and where you get food and what food does for your body. It's not just joyful eating, right? It fuels your body. It can make you sick. It can make you healthy. Mm-hmm. You know, food serves many purposes. And it was through that discovery that I started to become really passionate about like home cooking and like comfort meals, but made with healthier ingredients, right? Mm-hmm. And it was because my program was focused on farm to table. So it was like classic French with a farm to table spin on it. And so I got to spend time with Dan Barber up at Blue Hill, like, you know, on the farm, in the kitchens. It was an incredible experience, and really learned about the seasonality of food and, you know, why it's important to eat and buy local, et cetera. And so I started focusing more and more like on nutrition and healthy farming practices, and really learned how critical healthy food is for your body. And it was at about this time that the food TV stuff fell apart and I started to get really sick. Mm. And so it was like all happening at once, right? And if you have a big letdown at work from a career perspective, like, of course, you're going to be pretty bummed about that, right? It was like, I had been working on the food part of my life for a number of years at this point. And it was like, it was a really big letdown to be like, you know what? The TV networks are just totally changing direction. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not interested in you anymore. It's a big part of why I got out of entertainment, because I realized that for myself, like living paycheck to paycheck and like having to be hired consistently over and over again by like other people who determine like your value and your worth and like what you can provide to people basically is your own little commodity. It was just really challenging for me. I was like, okay, I need a normal job.
No, I totally get that. Yeah.
I need a normal job. I need a steady paycheck, and I'm really depressed and anxious on top of it. And I'm like getting all these infections, and I was going through a like awful breakup. And so everything had to fall apart for me, in order for me to rebuild from like square one.
I mean, I get that.
It was like the most devastating, probably 2 years of my life, just going through a hugely transformational moment. And at that point I was, you know, 29, 30 years old, just turning 30. There's a lot going on. It was really my quarter life crisis, you could say. But good things typically come from really challenging moments. It's how I learned that I can rely on myself above all else, and that I can contribute something meaningful to the world, regardless of what some people over here or over there think about me, right? It was at the time when the internet started to like really become more democratized and content creation was exploding. And people could really make a name for themselves on their own terms. And for me, as somebody that had been on reality TV for a really long time, and directors and like an editing bay got to determine which version of me the world was seeing and consuming, it was pretty cool for me to be able to reclaim my own voice, whether it was on Instagram or on my blog at the time, and start talking to people about my health challenges and what I was dealing with. I like wrote a blog post basically where I came out and said, I'm really depressed. And that was a pivotal moment for me. At that time, it was when I was starting to work on Love Wellness, when I was starting to heal my body, when I was moving away from the food space and really trying to figure out how I wanted to live the rest of my life. It, you know, communicating that to the world that I was unwell, that I was unhappy, really is what like set me free.
It's really interesting because I relate in a lot. And I think I'm one of those people similarly who's gone through a lot of like highs and lows, like crash and burns, and then you rebuild and then you start over. And I think it's one part of like being an entrepreneur. Like I always try to remind myself, when you listen to interviews of some of the most successful people in the world, they always took a risk or had something fail before something succeeded. And I always try to tell myself, like, that's just the journey. And I completely relate to that. And also, like, I'm 31 now, feeling that way. And when I was like 29, these years have been really transformative. And I totally relate to that feeling. And I think had those things not fallen apart, you wouldn't have found your true passion. And like, look at you now. It's incredible what things lead you to.
Yeah. I mean, I really am a firm believer in taking lessons from challenging moments. It's the reason why I'm at where I'm at. And it takes a lot of bravery to like come into your true self, but it doesn't matter what your job is, right? Like that doesn't define who you are, and that doesn't define bravery, right? It's like in any aspect of your life, right? Personal relationships, career, how you decide to be a parent or like be a daughter, right? You know, people can call on themselves in like any way that moves their life forward through a challenging time to like grow and develop and continue to push forward. So for me, it just happened to like be very career focused. But I wouldn't say that experience makes my like time and moment on earth like any more like special or valid than anybody else, right? It's just an experience in this like time space continuum that we're all having.
Totally. And you were also given opportunity at such a young age. And like, I always joke, like when I was younger, I had applied to a few reality shows or been scouted for a few. And I always say, like, thank God it didn't work out, because I was a very different person 5 years, 10 years ago than I am today. And like, I give you and anyone else who's come from like a situation like yours credit, because you're growing up with eyes on you and in a very different way. And then you're having to almost like ignore the validation or the hate from others and be like, okay, like, who am I? Like when all of this goes away, like, who am I as a person? And what do I want for my life? And I think it's cool that we've seen you like really take your time to figure it out and not be this like splashy founder. And just, it's like admirable in a way, because it's kind of easy to put your face on something. And I always think like, maybe you'll sell one product by like putting your face on it, but will you keep having repeat customers? It's kind of more so like your products speak for themselves without you needing to like be on the bottle.
Thank you. That's very kind. I mean, ultimately, listen, I started the company because a number of experts guided me towards a more simple and healthy way of living, right? Which was like, heal your gut, everything else will fall. And, you know, moving away from old legacy brand products that are made with, you know, toxic chemicals that like totally disrupt the vaginal microbiome, right? All these different things, all these learnings I put into the brand because I was just so tired of being sick and tired all the time, mm-hmm. right? It was absolutely exhausting. It was so exhausting that I literally started a company so that I could have resources, but that you could have resources too.
You made the solution for yourself. Yes.
And I mean, the feedback that we get every single day from all of our customers is so overwhelmingly positive. It keeps us moving forward and it keeps us really passionate about the category because there is still so much to do. Mm-hmm. There's still so much room to educate people just on body basics. Like, what is vaginal pH, right? Like, mm-hmm. how does it connect to the gut? How does the gut connect to the brain? There's so much room to continue to educate people. It's actually interesting to me that the onus really falls on brands at this point to do like the work of, I don't know, I don't want to say like government or school, right?
Yeah, yeah. like people that should be regulating these things. I agree.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, this is information that everybody should have access to and they don't. And now the internet is such a place that is guided by opinion instead of fact that it's like hard for people to discern the truth from, you know, bad information out there. Right.
1,000,000%. Like, we're all just trying to do our own research, but who knows if what we're even reading is factual information. Like, I don't know. Yeah. You see like an infographic getting like passed around. You're like, oh, this seems legit. It's like, who the hell knows who published that or what you're reading? Or that's why 100%. I was saying it's confusing as a consumer sometimes, because you're like, am I even reading the right information? Question for you that I love to ask people is, what does self-care look like to you? Like, how do you practice self-care?
For me, it's really about achieving a work-life balance. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as a founder, CEO, I'm operating the business every day, and I really try to practice what I preach. I get to the office at 9:30 and I leave by 5:30. I'm like, I'm done. And I insist that the entire team also does that.
I love that.
We're in the office 3 days a week. We have a great work flex from home policy. We have a great PTO policy. So I'm just really of the belief that, if you make time for yourself, right, and engage in the things that fill you up, like eating healthy, sleep, having a martini sometimes, if you know you are so inclined,
mm-hmm.
practicing a hobby. I just started golfing. Then, if you do those things and you like enrich your life in that way, you're going to be just as prepared and excited to show up at work every day and like give your job your all, right? Mm-hmm. Which ultimately pays your bills at the end of the day, right?
Sure does.
It's important to, you know, be able to take care of yourself in that way too. So I'm a big believer in work-life balance, and I absolutely practice what I preach.
I love that. That's amazing. This is really, really cool. Where could people buy your products? Stay tuned for your book. Like, give me all the things.
Yes. So, my book is called Love Yourself Well. It's available for pre-order right now, pretty much everywhere books are sold. It comes out on December 27th, and it includes a 5-week wellness plan for gut, brain, vaginal bliss. It's fabulous. So that comes out soon, but available for pre-order now. And then you can find Love Wellness, at a lot of places, at Target, at Ulta, on Amazon, or lovewellness.com. If you're like into savings, lovewellness.com is definitely the best way to go. But like, I love to hit up my local Ulta and see it on the shelves. It just makes me giddy.
So exciting. I'm so happy for you for this journey. I just realized we're recording this on October 27th. So 2 months from today, your book is out.
Oh, wow. Yes.
How crazy. When you said that, I was like, I looked at the calendar and I'm like, oh my God. So exciting.
2 months from today. I couldn't be happier to share this book with the world. Like, the science is so fascinating, and I really feel like it clearly communicates why we exist as a brand, how women's bodies work, how they are absolutely incredible, and serves as a really good guide on types of products you should be avoiding to support women's health.
I'm really excited to read this because I've been on this journey, like working with a health coach who's like telling me this brand's not that brand, this not, you know, like she's really helping me decipher labels and toxins and all of these things. And like, it's something I talk about. So I'm just like, any information I can get is just helpful. I'm like a sponge at this point. Like, I just want to absorb it and like learn. So I think that's going to be a really good read.
Yeah. Here's like one major takeaway when it comes to like women's personal hygiene products: do not buy anything with any kind of fragrance in it. It's really bad for you. It disrupts the vaginal pH, whether it's artificially derived or naturally derived.
Naturally, yeah.
It's a no-go. It's a no-go either way.
I used to be a publicist and I worked on some like big beauty brands and stuff. And I learned that sometimes like these companies that are marketing things as like naturally derived are just as bad as like the chemically stuff that you're putting in. So yeah, again, I get what you're saying. Like fragrance free, I guess, is just like the best way to move forward.
Well, you know, fragrance can be really irritating. Even naturally derived fragrances can have like 50 different ingredients in to like creative fragrance. It's wild. And fragrances, like the FDA doesn't require the ingredients in a certain fragrance or note to be listed on a label. So like, you don't know how much is really going into that product. And frankly, nobody's vagina needs to smell like a tropical breeze. You should just smell like you.
Just eat some pineapple. You'll be fine. That, you know, that thing that people will be saying.
Take vaginal health probiotics and like, you're going to be great.
I love it. Thank you so much for coming on and for all this information. Super helpful.
Thanks, Alyssa. It was such a pleasure.
Thank you.
Okay, guys, let's spill the tea. Let's start with Love is Blind. So where we last left off, we saw SK say no to marrying Raven, which literally has all of us shook. Spoiler alert, okay? This is a spoiler alert. Based on social media, actually, it shouldn't even be a spoiler alert because she's the one putting this information out there. Based on social media, Raven is really letting the world know that they're still together. Like, it is so obvious. She keeps liking comments of people like, I hope that you got back together after the show. I hope that you're still dating. She's liking all of them. So I think he just didn't want to get married right then and there, which I do understand. And I think that they're still together. And if that's the case, I'm down for it because I wanted them to get married. I saw it between them. They grew on me. I thought that they were a good couple. So I'm thinking they're still together, which doesn't make me as sad now knowing the outcome on the show. Where we left off, we saw, what's Bartice's, Nancy. Last we left off, we saw Nancy and Bartice. I do not think they're going to get married. I think Alexa and her man will get married. I think the ballerina and her guy will get married. I think Cole and Zainab won't get married. Overall, great freaking season. Good season. I mean, I think we could all agree the men are like assholes and they talk so much about the girls' looks when it's not like they're anything better. Like, no one's bad looking and no one's like Angelina Jolie. Like, everyone's nice looking and attractive. But these men think they're Brad Pitt, and it's like, you need to relax. It's not that deep. You're not better than any of these women. I actually think Zainab, am I saying this correctly? I think she's like the most beautiful person on the show. She's so beautiful. But yeah, it's good. It's really good. I'm loving this season. I put up a picture on my story. Ekansu and Davide posted a picture together from Love Island UK. And I posted it on my story and I said, Mom and Dad, although I do think this is a PR relationship. Because, you know, I'm a former publicist. I love to give my thoughts on those kinds of situations. I didn't tag them. I didn't think they would ever see it. I get a DM from Ek and Sue. Ek and Sue, my queen. Like, I love her. And she said, it's not a PR relationship. And I wanted to die because I hate trolls. But I also know that when you do, like, when people call out trolls, then the troll automatically backpedals. So I didn't want to backpedal. I wanted to stand by what I said because I think it's cowardly to backpedal. But at the same time, I didn't think she'd ever see it. And then I felt so bad because, like, if she really knew what I was saying about her all season, she would know I love her and Davide. And even if it is a PR relationship, I've always said from the jump, like, I want them to work out. So I messaged her back and I said, oh my God, I hate trolls and I don't want to be one. I hope more than anything that I'm wrong because I really am rooting for you guys. And she was just like, thanks, love, XX, like so classy, took the high road. And I just wrote back, class act. And that was one of those moments for me where I was like, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it. Because I felt like such an asshole. I was just giving my commentary on them. But I just felt like an asshole because you just don't realize this stuff penetrates people. And like, I should know of all people. And like, I still don't even think I said anything that bad, but I love her. And I'm like, oh, like, if you only knew, Ekin, if you only knew. So that was a little FML moment for me. Celebrities taking Ozempic. Okay, let's talk about it. I want to kind of Google what it is for you guys so we have the correct definition. This isn't like being talked about super like commonly right now, but basically Ozempic is an injection medication used to help control high blood sugar for people with type 2 diabetes. However, it has been being used for weight loss. And they're seeing a big uptick in Hollywood. I don't think people are talking about it. There has been a lot of allegations that maybe it's why the Kardashians have lost weight so quickly. I'm not going to make that assumption. Like, I don't know what people do in their spare time. So I don't really think it's fair to just assume it's like a drug when maybe they're just doing it a different way. Like, I'm not going to assume anything. That's like the big rumor that people love to talk about. And a lot of people are saying it's what a lot of celebrities have done. And I, even the other day, like, let's talk about it from a mental health perspective. Like, I found myself being like, should I go take that? Like, should I go get shots? Like, this, like, all you have to do is give yourself a shot and you lose weight. Like, oh my God. And then, you know, that's like the eating disorder brain or the disordered brain. And then your regular brain is like, bitch, slow down. Why are you going to put a substance in your body that you don't know the long-term effects? You don't know what it does to lose weight when all you have to do is go for a freaking jog and eat like a regular person. Like, it just feels like such a cheat sheet and it feels honestly quite dangerous. And, if you guys are hearing that this is a quick fix to lose weight and you're having the thought process like me, I just challenge you to think about the other side of the fact that, like, we don't know what this medication does. And it's kind of like the saying, like, if your friends are going to jump off a bridge, are you going to do it too? Like, just because everyone in Hollywood might be doing this, like, they've been doing a lot of healthy shit for a while and you don't see us out here doing all the same unhealthy shit. So stay true to yourselves. But I don't know if they're doing it. I'm sure it's prevalent in Hollywood a lot more than people realize. I'll try to like suss it out now that I'm in Hollywood. But yeah, it's a thing and you're going to start hearing about it a lot more. And then the New York Post had the audacity to post an article saying like heroin chic is back in with pictures of thin celebrities being like big butts are out, heroin chic is in. It's like, that is so toxic. And when are we going to stop using women's bodies as a trend? And you know what? Like, we could say what we want about the Kardashians making BBLs popular, but at least a freaking curvier body was in trend. We're not going back. Like, I'm sorry. It is just so ridiculous that people even think they could use that in a headline and make our weight a trend. Weight is not a trend. It is something that your body naturally goes through. It's not something that should be tampered with so easily. It's something that I can't even articulate how I feel because it makes my blood boil. Like, we go through enough shit. We don't need to feel like our bodies are being judged based on if they're in or not. How about we just exist in our bodies and live and be happy and not have to worry about people judging us? Like, oh my God, it was just so freaking toxic. And I'm so happy that people spoke out about it. And I'm curious if this new drug that I'm talking about is part of why that look is in. Like, what are they not telling us? I feel like us regular people don't understand like why celebrities look the way that they do. And we just need someone from the inside to tell us, like, okay, so are we all getting BBLs, or are we getting lipo, or are we taking Ozempic? Like, why do you guys look the way that you do when the regular population doesn't look that way? Because maybe if they normalized it and spoke about this stuff transparently, we would stop feeling like such fucking ogres. It's like Taylor Swift, that lyric in her new song, the monster on the hill. They're little babies and we're monsters on the hill because they're not letting us in on their secrets. And maybe if they told us what they were doing, we would feel like less ugly and just more poor, you know? But you're perfect the way that you are. All that to say, fuck these people, fuck these standards. Let's just normalize it amongst ourselves. And we don't need to look up to these celebrities for like our beauty standards. And I think that's like, you know, when Kim Kardashian was getting canceled for saying, get your fucking ass up and work. And when people get canceled for, or when she got canceled for saying that she lost weight to fit in the Marilyn Monroe dress. The reason why I don't take that stuff personally is because I'm like, I'm not basing my life decisions off what Kim Kardashian's doing. If you don't take people's advice personal, then it's not personal to you. Like, if she wants to do that, cool, that's not healthy for me, so I'm not going to do that. But we all live our own individual lives. And like, if you don't like what these celebrities are doing, don't pay attention to it. That's my point, because we don't have the resources that they have. We don't have the privilege that they have. We don't have the money, like anything. We don't have anything that they have, really. Nothing. So yeah, that's my rant on that, and that's what I think of that. And I dare you to kind of check yourself if you're feeling like your head is going down a toxic place when this stuff comes up. Dancing with the Stars, I went last night. Fantastic. One of the only shows I would literally sit in the audience for. Absolutely loved it, adored it. I think that Charlie is by far the best dancer there. I mean, Gabby is fantastic, and Gabby brings energy, and she's so good. But Charlie's very technically good. Like, Gabby's a natural born mover. Charlie's precise. She has precision. It's like every little like mark that she hits is sharp because she has that background. And I think that's the difference. So it's kind of like, what kind of dancer are you into? I think that's why the judges favor Charlie sometimes, because they're looking at it from a ballroom perspective of like form, and she's hitting all those marks. And watching her dance in person felt very fluid. It feels very easy and natural. I also thought Heidi did amazing, and she wound up going home in the double elimination. And I think it was her time to go, but I thought she did great. And I felt like the judges were hard on her, and I felt it. I felt her dance. Vinny, obviously his time to go. I saw him earlier this week at Erewhon and I was like, hey. No, I did not say hey. I would never. But his time to go. I think who we have left is great. I think the top three will be Shangela, Gabby, and Charlie. I think in a perfect world, we would see things get switched up. But at the end of the day, it's a show that's so based on fans. I think it's going to be really tight between Gabby and Charlie for number one. I think Charlie has more fans, but it depends if they're going to come through in the voting, which I would assume they will. But also, it's going to be tough either way for Gabby because we've seen a lot of bachelorettes win. I don't know. But then it's like Shangela brings something completely new to the table. So I think Shangela is like who I'd probably want to win because it's the most like different. And I think she's freaking incredible. It's really tough to say. Either way, I mean, it's a really competitive season. Everyone's fantastic. But yeah, that's my recap. And thanks for listening to this week's episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Don't forget to rate, review, subscribe. I will see you guys next Tuesday. Love you so much.